Okay, it's you. It's you. It's you, Ben. It's always you. Do you want to introduce yourself, Bridget?
Oh, hello. I am Bridget, maker, creator of music and art things.
All right. Thanks for letting us know that we're clear now. Ben, I'm going to give you endless ribbing about this later.
That's fine. I'll take it.
Mike Davis, Lovecraft eZine. Pete, you want to introduce yourself?
I'm Pete Rolick, writer, and I am burned out. Since December 24th, I have written 15,000 words.
Awesome.
So, five stories out the door.
Wow.
But, yeah. So, if I look a little, that's why.
But you do it all for your readers. And they appreciate it.
Do you get any sleep?
So here's the
he has clones.
It's a great question, Rick. I have progressively said I am going to sleep in. And because my wife and kids were gone, I had the opportunity to sleep in. In the first morning, I was up at 6:30, which is the same time I'm up every morning. And then the next morning I was up at 6. And then the next morning I was up at 5:30.
A lot of old people get up early in the morning, Pete. It's normal.
Yeah, no. And the dog is looking at me like, finally, on New Year's Eve, the dog and I went to sleep at 10:30.
Wait, what? The dog stayed up with you while you were running? Wow.
And
that is one hell of a support animal.
We slept in till 7 o'clock. Woohoo!
Wow.
Yeah. So, but no, Rick, I'm really not getting a lot of sleep, but it's all good. Coffee is my friend.
Matt.
Hi there. I'm Matt. I help run the eZine movie night. We started off the year with The Old Ways, and we're trying to choose a movie for next week. Anyways, there's also a prize for viewers and listeners. If you've ever been interested in the Lady Death comics of Brian Polito, this is a hardcover issue of a very well-drawn, high production value book. We will skip over the content, but if you want to win this, send an email to ezineprizes@gmail.com and put Lady Death in the subject heading.
I have to ask, Matt, why do you have that?
Because I thought it was like creepy or eerie, and it's not.
No, it's not.
So misleading. Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, we'll pick a winner in like 5 or 6 weeks. It could be you. You never know.
So you're really going with that? You thought it was creepy and eerie?
Yeah. I mean, that's when I was searching for like the Creeps magazine is like the nostalgic throwback that us oldsters were getting to replace creepy and eerie. And then the Creeps got shut down because they stole the name. So they renamed themselves Shudder. And then when I was looking around for something else, this came up. And I thought, oh, okay, I got a couple. And it's like, okay, this is a mistake.
Hey, Matt, why don't you try reading some Barotica?
Maybe not.
Yeah, well, and let me know how you like that.
Maybe not.
All right. Bill, you want to introduce yourself?
Bill Richardson, writer, artist, filmmaker. Sometimes a good guy.
And we have Gus Marino here with us today again. Yeah, he's going to be with us for the first hour anyway. So, Gus, you want to introduce yourself, bud?
Yeah, Gus Marino, author of the novel This Thing Between Us. Happy to be here. This is my second time, so... Yeah, I'm going for the top guests of the show. So I got two down.
And last but not least, Rick.
Rick Lay, writer and Pulp Magazine collector.
All right, so I read an article today. This is very important. That in the Washington Post, no less, your cat, here, this is the title of it. Your cat could burn your house down. Korean officials warn after 107 fires sparked by felines. This must be true. It's in the Washington Journal. So how many cats do you have, Ben?
Oh, I've got two.
All right. I've got six. So, and I've been through, you got to mute, otherwise I'm going to echo. I've been through two fires in my life too. There might be a connection there. I didn't think about it till just now. Thanks to Daniel Brom for the cool Christmas card. If you're watching or listening later, appreciate it, buddy. That was nice to get in the mail. Now, the thing to remember about our 2021 favorites is that we're, let's see, eight different people here. Some of our tastes overlap and some don't. So hopefully the listeners and viewers can get a good sense of, you know, what actually, if you haven't read a book or a movie or seen the movie or whatever, give you a list of things to content to peruse. So why don't we have Gus start with favorite movies or books or TV shows or all three?
All right.
No pressure.
How about I start favorite books?
All right.
Do that. All right. So I haven't read a lot of 2021 releases, but the ones that I did read that like really stuck out to me, one was Velocities by Kathy Koja, and the other one was My Heart is a Chainsaw by Stephen Graham Jones. And I mean, Stephen's book was just like, it knocked it out of the park for me. I was a little like, I want to say I maybe had like 100 pages left, and I was like, I don't know if this is going to be like my favorite one of my favorite Jones books. Like it felt like, I was like, oh, it's solid entry into his like over, like, but I wasn't sure if it was like one of the greats. And then you get to the ending, I was like, oh my God, he nailed it. Like it was such a great book. I had such a great time with it. Yeah, that was like my favorite book of 2021.
I haven't read it yet, but I think it's basically, the protagonist is basically the final girl type, right?
But like it's like the Mr. Miyagi of final girls. Like
he's great.
She is the like she's been this teacher waiting for the student for so long, until she finds the student and tries to make her into a final girl. But it's like, so it goes even beyond that. It's one of those books, I thought I had it pegged. I thought I knew what the story was. So like reading it, I was like, maybe just like going through the motions. I was enjoying it, but I was like, I think I know what's happening. And towards the end, my theory started falling apart and then it just got blown up. So I wholeheartedly recommend My Heart is a Chainsaw.
Well, I think The Only Good Indians by Stephen is 2020. But man, I was reading it. I was just reading it a year or so back. And then all of a sudden I'm like, what the fuck? What was this? You remember that scene that I'm talking about?
Oh my God. Yeah. Yes.
All right. And any other books you want to shout out about?
I think that's it for me. Did you want me to do TV and movies too?
Sure. If you'd like to, you know, my problem, you probably have the same problem I do, is that I read some 2021 books and I read a lot of books that weren't published in 2021 as well.
That's so, exactly what I do.
Yeah.
So for movies, I've got kind of cheating. I put The Empty Man on here. It was released in December 2020, but because like Disney just dumped it, but I'm like, it counts. It's easily one of my favorite horror movies ever. Candyman. I really liked Candyman just because being from Chicago, I'm used to seeing the city portrayed like the same way it does in every portrayal, which is basically like Blues Brothers version of Chicago, where like you just see downtown and just like
the
very,
river
very,
and the bridges.
Yeah, the river, like super generic. And Candyman was the first time where I saw the city as like something spooky. And it was so refreshing. I loved seeing places that I recognized, but in a different light. And I just the intro of the movie where like the city has been like inverted during the credits. It was so beautiful. So Those are my movie recommendations.
Pete, you really liked Candyman too.
I did. I, you know, Candyman for me is kind of this weird series. And to be clear, the 2021 Candyman film makes it a series. The previous three films were very unconnected. This fourth one really does a really good job of creating a arc, overarching mythos to bring them all together and make them make sense. But what's amazing to me is that it's a Clive Barker film and the original story is not set in Chicago. It's set in England.
That, you know, and I've always wondered that. I've always wondered, like, how did Clive Barker pick this outside of Chicago?
He didn't. But
wow, that's awesome.
It's amazing that the Candyman is now a very definitive American monster.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, I love Candyman. It's probably the best filmed movie I've seen all year.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
And while we're all giving our lists, like our picks, like Gus is doing right now, everybody feel free to jump in and comment on whoever's, you know, whatever the person's saying at the time. I don't want it to turn into a series of eight lectures or anything like that. What's your TV picks then, Gus?
So TV picks, I've got another one that was premiered in December, but then like finished in like February of 2021. And that is 30 Coins. It was a series on HBO. I don't know if you guys saw it.
Yeah.
Amazing. Yeah. Absolutely like amazing show. It has everything that I go for. It like the whole spiritual religious aspect, the monsters, the like just the bigness of the horror and the philosophy behind it, of just like the idea of like evil as not only like a necessity, but like, you know, doing God's work. It has like all of the elements of Midnight Mass, but I think just done in a different way that really, really connected with me. I thought it was just like an amazing, amazing show.
And I think 90% of what you just said applies to one of my picks in books, This Thing Between Us by Gus Marino. You know, I'm like, okay, this is cosmic techno horror, but it's also a bit of religious folklore horror, and so many other things, and the hugeness of the horror and not being able to really define the horror, at least when I was reading the book, I'm thinking, you know, you finish the book and it's horrifying and it's a great book and you still don't know really, you still have this fear of the unknown thing going on, which is really key. You know, it's great.
Yeah. That kind of horror is like my wheelhouse. I absolutely love it. So like 30 Coins, even though 30 Coins has like a, its horror is like based in a religion, like it was so effective. It was just such a good show. So, so good. I think like that's my favorite thing about works that really take religion and spirituality into account, is like not so much making it as like the boogeyman, because that, I think not that like you can't, but that's a very tried and true horror trope, that like for them to kind of like elevate the quote unquote bad guys in the show, it was ingenious. I'd never seen anything like it. I didn't know anything about the religious sect that's in the show. And as soon as I watched it, I like read as much as I could just because it was so fascinating. So yeah, 30 Coins was like my favorite TV experience. That and like Bo Burnham's Inside were like my two favorite things of 2021.
Awesome. I'm writing things down as you talk and as Pete was talking, and I'm pretty sure anyone listening is probably doing that as well. Bridget, you want to talk about some of your picks?
Sure. So yeah, 2020, 2021 feels like it went on forever.
2020 plus one.
Yeah, something like that. So I was going through my list and realizing that I didn't actually read a whole lot this year. Read a lot of random stories. A lot of that was just, I wasn't commuting as much, and a lot of what I read is on Audible or audiobooks. So I didn't read a whole lot, but my favorite book, I think, of the year was definitely Come With Me. Ronald Malfi,
yeah.
It's just an amazing, amazing story with lots of, you know, the theme of haunting, but there's so much more than just ghosts, but what haunts us in general, that I thought was, it was just really well done. But movies, I thought about a lot of things that were notable for, or like experimented with different concepts that I enjoyed. I actually really liked The Manor, the Blumhouse movie. I thought it was a really interesting take on the old Gothic mansion growing old, and the kind of gaslighting that happens sometimes with that.
Okay, so it is good. It's kind of been on my maybe list to watch.
I liked it. I'd also heard the director do a podcast before I saw the movie, and so that maybe influenced me a little bit in how I viewed it, but I think it went up to a place that I didn't expect, and it was very interesting. Candyman's already been mentioned, love that. I liked the Fear Street trilogy for a lot of reasons. I think it was really neat that they did that the way they did it, with releasing, you know, one movie a week for 3 weeks. And so it created this really cool experience where people watched the one movie on a very specific timeline, talked about it, anticipated the next one, talked about it, anticipated the next one, you know, a lot of varying opinions about how successful it all was. But for me, I loved it. I thought it was a lot of fun. There was a lot of clever things in there, you know.
I thought it was
other great. Plot holes, sure. There's, you know, but it was, I thought for what they were trying to do, it was just a really cool experience that they created.
I thought it was just really fun to watch. So.
Yeah. And then shout out to Werewolves Within. That was genius and hilarious. And I love horror comedy. There were just so many things about it that were really great. I loved it. I watched a lot of TV shows, apparently. I had a huge list of those, but the Chucky series was probably my favorite. I think that it fell within the mythology without looking contrived. It just built on what makes Chucky Chucky.
Can I stop you for a second? Did anybody else watch this Chucky series? I didn't. No? Pete? You couldn't squeeze it in between? No. Right? Jeez.
Well, I actually took a while to watch it too, because I was like, do I really want to watch another Chucky thing? Or, okay, Chucky, what are they going to do that's new with it? You know?
Yeah.
But I thought it was handled really well, because in the Chucky movies, it's kind of a short game, you know? And how are they going to do that in a series in the long game? And I thought the way they handled it was really great, because it's very focused around teenagers, which most of the movies are, and then people not believing them, or people thinking that they're the murderers, you know, that's kind of a common theme in the Chucky movies. But they just, the way they built up the characters and the relationships of the teenagers, and then the mythology of Chucky in general, and there's a really good arc in there. There's some imminent danger for the world, I guess you could say. That was done really well.
Does it take place in Chicago?
I'm trying to remember now.
Chucky's kind of town.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to look, because it the way they did it, it seemed like it could take place anywhere. So I don't honestly remember. But yeah, Chapel Wait was really good too.
Oh God, yeah.
And
did you guys like the ending? I'm not going to spoil it, but did you guys like the ending?
I liked it because it was the hard choice. It was the sacrifice, you know, save the world kind of situation, but it was a very sad ending, but I loved it.
Pete has a "I disagree" look on his face.
Can I say something? I wasn't I wasn't sure where he was going on the boat, the father. And also they had a problem with when it's sort of sunlight and when it's sort of twilight on that movie. Yeah, we don't know the series. Well, a lot of times we're expecting vampires to burn up, but they're surviving, but it's sort of, I guess, twilight. And that was where the conclusion took place.
Yeah, I definitely had questions about that too, but.
Well, you're saying so if there's not direct sunlight, they're fine. Is that what you mean?
Well, when the vampire is rowing a boat into the water,
yeah.
I didn't say who the vampire is. That can be destroyed, and it's not darkest night.
Yeah,
I don't know. I just figured that he'd kind of end up on the first ship that he found, and you know, prey on
that. That maybe. I mean, there were a lot of things I liked about the show, but it just could have been neater in the conclusion.
I got the feeling he was basically going to be David Banner in Wonder of the Earth, you know, or something.
I also was disappointed that we didn't see the worm.
Mm.
We were building that up for like many episodes.
Before we get too far, Emma Gibbons watching, author Emma Gibbons. Favorite book, she says, Big Dark Hole by Jeff Ford. Yeah, anything Jeffrey Ford writes is great. I haven't read that one yet. Harrow the Ninth by Tamsin Moore, if I'm saying her last name right. And the new audio of The Sandman. That was an audio drama, if I remember right. And she liked the new Matrix, so I'm going to have to agree to disagree with you, Emma. And then she liked What We Do in the Shadows.
Yes, What We Do in the Shadows was awesome.
Yeah, that's a great show.
So, okay, Bridget, anything else?
Yeah, movies? Just lastly, I was going to say, like, by far the scariest thing, I haven't even finished the series yet. I kind of think it went off the rails around episode 4, but the scariest episode was definitely the first episode of Hellbound.
Oh.
That I've seen on TV. But yeah, I think like the third or fourth episode was kind of going off the rails and I lost interest, but this year that was the scariest episode, was that first episode. It was pretty cool.
Yeah, that was, had a hell of a lot of what the fuck moments, you know, is this really happening?
yeah.
Pete, you want to go or do you want to wait? Oh, are you done, Bridget? I'm sorry. I should ask.
Oh, yeah, that was.
I thought you were. Yeah.
What did I think was really good this year? Candyman was really good this year in film.
Mm-hmm.
Gaia and In the Earth are films that you should watch because they have the same exact theme and pretty much the same plot, but they're handled very, very differently. I think Gaia is a little bit better, but they're both very competent and, you know, good films to watch. Television series 30 Coins has, if you like your supernatural horror with a heavy hand of Catholicism, absolutely. If you want an even heavier hand of Catholicism, Evil is right up there. And you know, Evil, I think, is really well acted. Yes. A little bit better than 30 Coins. The one thing I liked about 30 Coins is that the lead actress in that, who ends up being the villain, is actually the girl
from Dagon.
Oh, yeah.
The Stuart Gordon film. So there's a there's a throwback. It was like looking at her going, where have I seen that person? And it's like, oh, yeah. Yeah, I've seen her with all her tentacles. But yes.
Just to go back to your comment on evil, as a Catholic, I would say it's not uncritically Catholic.
Say that again.
You get a very even, I mean, you get some very critical comments on the Catholic Church.
Oh, yeah.
For instance, yeah. Their policy towards race has been called out.
The thing is, they're such an easy target. It's part of it is they've been around so long, so they have a track record of judgments you wish they hadn't made necessarily. But on the other hand, the thing that also is just irresistible to filmmakers is iconography.
Right.
Going, it's like in the Western world, what organization can go back 2,000 years and have symbolism and iconography and hidden secrets? And, you know, now, like, I suppose if you're in China, they'll find a different deep past source. But in the Western world, there's no one like the Catholic Church for that sort of thing. So,
and generally, for China, it's Journey to the West.
Right. So I just think we're still going to see this. We all sort of groove on it.
Yeah.
Yeah, the whole Spanish Inquisition thing, I think, was a bad move on their part.
But it's also like with The Exorcist, right? Like, you look at the effect that movie had on the culture. Almost none of the movies like they deal with exorcism, they're always the Catholic Church, right? It's rarely the Orthodox, or it's rarely Jewish, it's rarely Protestants. And it's because, as Matt mentioned, like, you have like the big crucifix, you have the speaking in Latin. These are things that kind of underlie our Western culture as a whole.
Can I just comment then? The movie, The Old Ways, that we watched last night, they go to Aztec for these sources. And the exorcism is, I'm going to butcher the pronunciation, I apologize, in Nahuatl, the Aztec language. The symbols used are Aztec, like, death whistles. So in a sense, it's going into a different tradition for that, which is one reason I kind of liked it, I think.
Well, there was an episode of Evil where they had competing exorcisms. They had an Islamic exorcism going on the same time as the Catholic exorcism.
Is Evil on Paramount Plus?
I think so.
It's on Paramount Plus.
Evil is all around us. Just take a look.
But there are two, yes.
It was originally on CBS and then it became Paramount Plus.
Pete, you want to say anything else?
Yeah. Brand new cherry flavor was overlooked immensely. It's a great, weird revenge story set in LA.
It's also, if you're squeamish, it's a little hard to watch. I'll put it that way.
Yes. You know, vomiting kittens is not... It turns out that vomiting kittens is the preferred way to do it. There are other ways that, you know, we discover. Peninsula, you know, I thought, you know, the sequel to Train from to Busan, Peninsula, was pretty good.
Wait, there's a sequel to Train?
But there are two sequels to Train to Busan.
Oh, all right.
There's a, what is it? There's an animated prequel, right?
If you say so.
Okay. I say so.
Yeah, I think that's right.
Why don't they come up like Truck Caravan to Busan? You know.
We could do Speed, the bus, with Sandra Bullock. And
yeah,
and
Speed to Busan. Keanu. This would be great.
Did I see where Keanu Reeves is in negotiation for Speed 4?
Oh my God.
Well, they got to do it in London so that they can get the double-decker bus. You know,
so that's television.
Stay with me.
Film, books. I'm like Bridget. Apparently, I didn't read a lot of books this year.
Or if you did, they were not from 2021.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. The best thing I probably read all year was Confessions of an Opium Eater by Tom Quincy. Like, what's that, 1884?
Yeah, you're a little off. But
I'm a little off by...
More like 1840s.
Okay, 1840s? Okay. But yeah, pretty early. I found a copy and was like, oh, you know what? I've never read this. I should read this. You know, it's it sets the tone for a lot of stuff that comes later, like Basketball Diaries and Junkie. You know, it really, you can see where that whole genre of literature has come from.
There's a Vincent Price movie supposedly based on that. That is nothing. It's really a Fu Manchu story, basically.
Surprise. So anyway, that's what I got.
Matt.
Okay, so I basically ignored all the rules.
Of course.
So for books, stuff piles up. I read it when I read it. So I want to show you one of the books that I really loved getting this year was this Called by Cthulhu, the updated art book by Dave Carson, who was in the 90s and 2000s, illustrated a lot of Lovecraftian art. And this is a gorgeous, it's not glossy color, but you know, it's still beautiful art in a really nice book.
It is.
So
Matt, did you find the error?
Well, some of us spend our lives enjoying the now and others look for errors.
Poor Dave Carson.
He printed the same print twice, about 10 pages apart.
Oh, okay. Well, no, I didn't notice. I was looking at the pictures.
In case you wanted to view it twice.
Okay, exactly. Now, in terms of books that I read, they didn't necessarily come out like you're talking about My Heart is a Chainsaw. I really liked The Only Good Indians. And the other book that I've read just lately I really liked was Roadside Picnic, which was the basis for the book for the movie Stalker. And this is an old book. Copyright was 2012.
Well, you're later.
No, actually 1972 was when they originally wrote it.
I was gonna say.
Yeah.
Okay. So then,
but it's not 1840s.
Right. No. Okay. So then what I said was, well, what about comic books? You know, I still like to collect Lovecraftian adaptations. And of course, you all know Blue Fox Comics has been doing sponsored books on Kickstarter. And this was a previous one for The Mountains of Madness. So their latest one is an adaptation of The Shadow over Innsmouth. Now, the one thing they do is they choose to make Robert Olmsted look like HPL, which I could have lived without. But so far, they've gotten through to where he's met Zadok Allen in the two volumes that have come out. You could probably just wait for the hardcover compilation, which will probably be in a year or so.
Probably marketing thing.
No, that's they sponsor a Kickstarter to produce a couple books, then they'll eventually do a compilation. Similarly, from a different company, there's a really nice adaptation of the music of Eric Zahn, and this was by Target Destroyed Comics.
Really, I love that Lovecraft story. It's one of my favorites.
You know, and what they are starting to do now is see how the student is African-American. Mm-hmm. A lot of these adaptations are updating the people. So like they put people of different races and genders into roles and it doesn't hurt a thing. Do you know what I mean? It's actually kind of nice to see it more reflects the reality of the world. So those comics are out. I did find a nice anthology. I think it's going to be a series. It's sort of like Creepy and Eerie, but it's called OMG, a Horror Anthology. And I believe it was also a Kickstarter. And then finally, if you say not Lovecraftian adaptations, but inspired by, I can't find my compilation, but there was a series of like, I think five books called Miskatonic, where Thomas Malone is working with an FBI agent in the 20s, but she's a woman. So she's had to put up a lot of grief in her life and she's really tough. So she's the kind of character I like. So there's a series called Miskatonic, which is very enjoyable. Okay, well, what about movies? Now, I am really lucky to be hosting movie night. So every time we have movie night, I get to see something super fun. And we have had, I've got an album on my Facebook page. Every time I post a feature for movie night, you can scroll through and see all the movies we've seen over the years. And none of these movies are necessarily 2021 movies. But for example, I finally saw A Girl Walks Home Alone. I don't think I've seen a movie in Farsi before, let alone a vampire movie. I really enjoyed, we watched both The Wolf of Snow Hollow and Werewolves Within, which were full of humor as well as werewolves. And they were great.
That's 2020, but I love The Wolf of Snow Hollow.
We just watched Suicide Squad, the second one. It was a blast, considering how crap Birds of Prey was. I really enjoyed it. And then if you're going to say less comic movies, I did really enjoy The Empty Man. I thought that was super well made, well done, extremely Lovecraftian.
Yeah.
I also just saw the first part of Dune, and I was astonished at how good it was. I really enjoyed the adaptation. Very true to the book. Also more diverse, which I like. You know, it's just a well-made movie of a movie, a book I didn't think could be filmed. As far as TV goes.
You know, I got to interject something about The Wolf of Snow Hollow. You know how I'm always saying, you know, going cold, if you know it's going to be good, if a friend says it's good or whatever, don't watch the trailer. Just going cold to a horror movie. Well, except for The Wolf of Snow Hollow, that's got to be the funniest trailer I've ever seen. You know, where he's talking about, I've been on the program for 6 years, sober for three, you know, and what was it? Was that Robert Mitchum in the movie? I think.
No, Robert Forster.
Thanks. He's like, I'm not going to ask you to pray with me because of the goddamn lawyers.
That was his last movie, I think.
Yeah.
Before he died.
Yeah, so TV, Matt. Sorry.
Okay, so for TV, I like People of Earth. I sort of watched all the episodes of both seasons this year. I'm really disappointed they canceled it. You know, kind of like when they canceled Alphas on essentially a cliffhanger. It's such a shame because it was so enjoyable. I also am enjoying What We Do in the Shadows. I'm nowhere up to date, but like every few weeks, I kind of conserve it. I watch an episode here and there. I do the same thing with the new show, Ghosts. I don't watch the British version. I'm watching the American version. This is Bridget's suggestion, and it's cute, and it's amusing, and there's actually the lead male actor, I forget his name, had to do an episode where he essentially was mimicking one of the lead actresses. He was super at it. He was so funny. I was like, that was actually the funniest episode for me just because of how he was doing the mimicry.
I haven't seen any of those. Sounds so like I should.
In terms of related TV, I guess my favorite TV show was Chapel Waite. Adrian Brody was fine in the lead. The cinematography was good. The set design was good. The acting was very good. It was very creepy and sustained tension, slowly building. I have a few issues with the end, like Sis is a vampire now. Okay.
Yeah.
No problem. Oh boy, will she make cheerleader? I don't know.
For the next 100 years, yeah.
One thing they did good on that show was they reversed the trope of the bride from the South Seas.
Yes.
In that deep ones, or you know,
no, sources. they were the nice people.
They were the good people,
right? So that's basically, I have super enjoyed movie night because I'd say three quarters of what we watch is good. Some of the stuff is watchable, and we only watch a few clunkers. So I'm really enjoying that.
Our new slogan. We only watch a few.
Just watch clunkers. A few clunkers.
Everybody has to watch a few clunkers in their life, my friend.
Yeah, you can join Matt and everybody on movie night every Saturday night. You can just, for more info, just go to the Lovecraft eZine website and lovecrafteZine.com and click on events. And it's the Saturday, you know, we do something Sunday, Tuesday, Thursday, and so on. It's a Saturday event, and it'll give you a link to Cast, which is the program Matt uses for movie night. So that's how you can do that if you're interested in doing that. So all right, so we're gonna try Ben and see if he echoes or not.
All right,
you do, young man.
Look, I switched the microphone source and I kicked my family out, so we should be good here, but I'll watch the chat and see. And I'll go quick as well. As far as books, apparently I didn't read a single novel written in 2021, but I did read Immortal Hulk. So if you haven't, if you're not aware what it is, it was a 50 issue comic book series that ended this year in October. And it's like a really unique take on the Hulk as more of like a horror series, right? And the idea is that the Hulk is tied into sort of a Marvel Universe version of the devil, but like, gosh, I feel like we could do a whole episode on Marvel's understanding of the devil and how there's different, like, you have Mephisto here, but this is like an ultra devil down below. And it was really fantastic. It's probably the best Hulk series since Planet Hulk. So if you're a fan, I definitely recommend checking it out. There's a lot of horror involved, a lot of body horror type stuff. The way the artist, Joe Bennett, draws the Hulk's transforming is really awesome.
Is that the one you sent to me?
I sent you, I think, the first trade worth. Yeah. Okay. And
yeah,
it's,
I got to continue
reading. And a bunch of the covers are by Alex Ross, too.
All 50 covers. All 50 covers are Alex Ross. So you get a lot of really amazing. I mean, it's, and I would argue the covers are some of his best work. It's just really amazing. So
absolutely.
That's saying something.
Yeah, I'd highly recommend that. So that counts as my book. But I promise it's better than most of the novels you probably read this year. Just promise that. For TV series, it'll be like last time.
What about this thing between us? How would you compare? Is it better than this?
Yeah, damn, Ben. I just had a book come out this year.
Yeah. No offense. But for TV series, what we do in Shadows is... as everyone else mentioned it, so I caught up this year. The new season was probably the best of the three. And, you know, just I'm assuming most people are familiar with it now because we keep bringing it up. But if you're a fan of any vampire thing at all, it's really great. And it's definitely the kind of comedy where it's not really a parody. It's more of like the kind of satire where you can enjoy it the more you know.
I don't know. I don't like vampire comedy.
If you want to give it a try, the original movie that came out in 2014 with Taika Waititi is it's on Hoopla if your library has that, and that's a great kind of preview of what the series is like. Though I would argue the TV series is actually better.
Here's the problem. I turned 50 like half a year ago. I'm about to turn 51.
Sure, only half a year ago. Uh huh.
Yeah. Yeah. I have a limited number of hours left in my life. Mm-hmm. And I need to decide how best to use those hours. You know what I mean? Well, how old are you, Matt?
I'm a day over 70. I've reached the age where I like to consider myself venerable.
Vulnerable? Yeah, you're vulnerable. All right, Ben. Anything else?
Yeah. So as far as movies go,
I think Gus wants to berate you or something.
Yeah.
You know what? I did, but for what we do in the chat. So I've seen the movie. I love the movie. Last time I was on this show, you told me to give it a chance. So I finished the first episode. I didn't realize I didn't watch the ending. Finished the first episode. Watched the second episode. My question to you is, when does it get good?
Now let me wait, let's stop right there, because this is, let's draw a comparison here. Ben recommended something to you guys. I recommended something to you.
Oh yeah.
And you know, let's,
one of my favorite horror movies ever.
Yeah, let's just, yeah. Who, like, do you want to listen to here?
I, you know what? That's a very good point.
Hey, you know, I did recommend an album to you as well. Just throwing
it
out there.
Oh, and you killed it with that. I absolutely loved that album.
Damn it.
And you
what,
got me
what was the album?
Got me listening to Stabbing Westward again. So thank you for that.
It was The Dreaming Etched in Blood. It came out, I don't even know. It's great though. Whenever it came out. What we do in Shadow. So the first season, I feel like it picks
Although
up.
I did like Fright Night.
Everyone liked.
You have to like Fright Night, right? It's a classic. Like,
the original, not the new one.
Right.
The 80s Hitler. Film?
The 80s film, yes. Where have you been?
Where did that come from?
Yeah. Thank you, Bridget. I'm just like.
Okay. If you didn't understand the segue, I was saying I don't like comedy vampire horror. But then I realized that Fright Night, I like.
1985.
Okay, well, the thing about what we do in the shadows, okay, it's this very specific kind of comedy. If you liked The Office,
love The Office.
If you like
that, yeah, I like The Office.
Mockumentary, like, you know, documentary.
Kind of comedy, you might have sold
camera,
me
fourth wall kind of thing. Then a lot of it is very dry, and there are some episodes that you're like, what the hell did I just watch? But it's the overall, like,
no.
But it's also super creative.
It's
super creative. I mean, it has the very best werewolf versus vampire fight ever.
It will never
be popped.
Yeah,
I go with that too.
You have to at least watch it until that werewolf versus vampire fight.
Well, I mean, like the third episode.
Yeah, I love it. Gus, Gus is like, Ben, so my question to you is, when does it get good?
Yeah. Okay,
I thought the emotion vampire was good too.
Oh, amazing! I love that. Yeah.
All right, so Bridget, it's often for me, it's WTF doesn't say what the fuck. It's like, why the fuck did I just watch this?
You guys set yourself that every day.
Yeah. You well, so you know, Llamageddon was a low point.
It was such a high point for us on the chat.
Oh, that's right. For those who don't know, I forgot about this. Pete live streamed to us, basically, in our Facebook commentary while he was watching Llamageddon. We forced him to do this. Who made you do this, ultimately? I think it was DeBronzo.
Yeah.
Nagged the hell out of you until you finally watched Llamageddon. So he's watching it, and he's like saying, what was he saying, Bridget? He's like saying things like, I can't believe you guys fucking made me do this. And shit like that.
This is this guy's third outfit change in 8 minutes.
Right.
It was the greatest riff tracks without us watching the movie at the same time.
Oh,
it was a wonderful low for Pete, and like Bridget said, a wonderful high for us. So, yeah. Were you going to say something, Gus?
No. So, okay. Well, watch episode 3 then.
It's the third episode. Yeah.
That's when Gus, just so you know, that's when I quit.
Okay. And I love everyone involved. I like Jermaine Clements, Taika. I love the movie, that style of comedy. I can, as I'm watching the show, I'm like, it's just there, but it's not like hitting me where I need it to. So I'm when does that happen?
It does.
I like chocolate, cilantro, and garlic.
But not together, hopefully.
That's my point. You can't put them all together and expect them to work.
I think Bridget sold me on this when she said, if you like The Office, you'll probably like this.
Some of the episodes
of The Office suck, honestly, but it's still a great show.
Yeah, sure. I'd say this show, like, definitely by episode 7, because episode 7 has a lot of really great guest stars that it really, really great. And you'll be shocked, like, some of the people you see in it. So if you don't like episode 7, if you don't like the show, then see a therapist.
If Wesley Snipes as Blade doesn't show up in episode 7, I'm going to be so upset.
You just got to watch it. I don't know what else to say. You just got to watch it. But they do a great job of incorporating a lot of that stuff. So that was easily my favorite series of the year. And as far as movies go, I'd say Spider-Man No Way Home.
That was good.
It's
my first theater experience in over 2 years.
So I saw that on Saturday. I was dragged from the house
and a friend of mine took me to see that. And I will say,
how do you go on with friends like that? I mean, this is the, you know, making you go to watch a fun movie.
I will say that it was an okay movie until Andrew Garfield saves, what's her name, MJ. And then it was just a tearjerker for me. So, because after that, they started hitting very emotional points in both in the script. So, yes.
You mean it wasn't emotional when somebody died? Yeah, I'm not going to mention. I was in tears on that one.
Kind of knew that was going to happen.
I mean, to me, the big thing was, we've had this MCU Spider-Man, Tom Holland, for several years, and I disliked both of the previous movies. He didn't feel like Spider-Man to me. He felt like Iron Man Jr. He had no sense of loss and responsibility that's sort of central to what makes Spider-Man Spider-Man.
Yes.
And it's funny because in Homecoming, they implied that there was an uncle. In Civil War, he when he talks to Iron Man, they kind of imply that something happened. And in Homecoming, there's like he has a suitcase that has Uncle Ben's initials on it. And he looks at it kind of longingly. But in this movie, they made it clear that there never was an Uncle Ben, which kind of fits. And that's one of the things I disliked about it, because they didn't want to show for the third time in whatever it would have been, 15 years, Uncle Ben dying. This movie made him feel like a real Spider-Man to me. And seeing him on screen with other Spider-Men, I don't know how or whatever the plural is of Spider-Man. Yeah, I don't know. It was great seeing him not only hold his own as an actor playing the same character, but seeing those versions of Spider-Man get kind of a proper appearance. It wasn't just cameos. They weren't just kind of there for jokes. They had their own good, solid moments in the film. I say it's easily the best MCU film, in my opinion. And it's also great as a Spider-Man film if you've watched all 8 of the other films kind of coming into that one. And in fact, even like the villains in it were better than they were in their original movies. So like Green Goblin was a much better villain in this than he was back in 2002. It blew me away. What's his name is Electro?
Jamie Foxx?
Jamie Foxx, yeah, gosh. I mean, there are things I love about Amazing Spider-Man 2, and Electro was not one of them. So it was great seeing him there.
That movie was bad.
I love the ending of that film, but yes, that movie was bad. But I also loved Andrew Garfield sort of getting his redemption moment in this film. And I don't care if I'm spoiling it for anyone. It's your fault for not seeing the best movie of the year. So
Pete already spoiled it.
Yeah, that's true. Andrew Garfield gets kind of a redemption moment there, and it really lands.
I think everybody knows that all 3 Spider-Man are in there.
And also I loved the Andrew, like when Tobey Maguire shows up and he's not wearing a Spider-Man outfit. And I'm thinking they're doing what Tom Welling did in Crisis, right? Where he shows up, but he refuses to put on the costume. And then, so Andrew Garfield turns to him and says like, so are you gonna dress for battle? Or are you gonna be dressed like a youth pastor?
Yeah, that was and hilarious.
It was this really great line. And then he lowers the shirt and he's got the Spider-Man outfit on. There are just a lot of really great moments between Andrew Garfield, Tom Holland, and Tobey Maguire that I didn't expect to get that kind of thing out of a movie. So it's not a horror movie, but that's because I didn't see any good horror movies this year. Halloween Kills was terrible and heartbreaking after the last one. So if that's the only horror movie I watched, then I pick Spider-Man.
Hmm. All right. Well, you obviously didn't see the advent calendar or anything like that, right?
No. That I want to watch stuff on Shudder, but my wife may kill me if I subscribe to another streaming service. So,
you know, that's what we call an acceptable risk. But...
I'm going to play her a clip of you saying that, Mike. And so then she can go to Texas and kill you.
She'll
instead.
Love me for that.
Mm-mm.
Yeah, that might backfire on you.
You know, I'm going to talk to Danielle about this and about how you're trying to get me in trouble, and we'll see what happens.
I don't have to try very hard. All right, so if we're done talking about Spider-Man, yes, I did love it. Advent calendar, do you guys all see that? Most of you?
Yeah, I haven't logged into my Shutter account in a few weeks. So.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
I saw it. It was awesome.
Yeah, I liked it. Another movie I really liked was Caveat. It does have a couple problems, but it's also a movie that I keep thinking about, which, you know,
could be a good thing, could be a bad thing.
I keep thinking about it in a good way. It was a very creepy movie. It could have been better, but it was really good. I would definitely recommend any horror fan to watch Caveat. It's kind of a slow burn, of course. Bridget, I think, mentioned the Fear Street trilogy, so I love that. I won't say too much about that, except I agree, I loved it.
I think that was a very ambitious thing that they did. Mm-hmm. And I would like to see more with Netflix or Showtime or HBO or whatever. I'd like to see more attempts at that. Let's play with film. Play with the concept of what you can do with it. Because you can do stuff more with it now. You're not tied to the big screen.
Yeah, like I keep saying, we're in another golden age of television, and they can take a lot more chances than they used to be able to take when we were just, you know, on cable TV.
You know, last week we were, or the week before, I don't remember, we were discussing like DC and the CW crossovers. Imagine, and it doesn't have to be a superhero series, but imagine a group of series that are all set in the same fictional town that just cross over with each other.
Yeah.
Like.
Well, Hulu's doing that with Castle Rock.
Yeah. But I'm thinking like, you know.
Too bad it's terrible.
Yeah. But
like Chicago PD and Chicago Fire and that kind of, all the, like the Dick Wolf's kind of stuff, right?
Right.
Oh yeah. Doing that in a horror way. That's a great.
Right. So like you could do like a show set in a hospital, a show set in a police station, a group of lawyers, an ambulance group, and they could just have regular stories, but the ambulance always goes to the hospital. And then you could follow a character through the crime, through the pickup, the rescue, through the recovery, through the lawsuit, and, you know, and really have fun with that.
And ultimately through the revenge arc.
Yeah. And, you know, and yes, it could be done as a horror series or as a, God, it could be done really good as a serial killer series.
Well,
you know, but
not to beat a dead horse, but the other thing I will say, what Bridget said about one film per week, giving people time to talk about each episode and anticipate the next episode. That was great, instead of just dumping them all at once. So
it's a different kind of strategy, right? You know, there's the Netflix strategy is
they
like
took a chance and it worked.
Dumps them all at once and gets really big buzz for a weekend, maybe a week.
Exactly.
And then,
you know, I think
Disney with Marvel is doing these where they're releasing maybe one or two episodes up front, and then to reel you in, and then you're watching it and talking about it for 6 to 8 weeks.
Right.
Well, it's also a difference in the kind of the reach of the platforms, right? Because Netflix knows you're not going to unsubscribe from Netflix once the series is over. So they'd rather release a new series every couple of weeks and hook you that way.
Thanks,
right?
Gus.
See, Gus, you're the best.
Love you.
See you, everyone. Thanks for having me on.
Bye, Gus. Have a good one.
Netflix knows that you're going to stay subscribed for The Witcher at the beginning of December, and you're not going to unsubscribe because you've got Cobra Kai coming up right at the end of the month.
Shows I don't watch.
No,
you guys don't, but a lot of people do. That's how Netflix sees it. Whereas if you look at, let me just ban the spam bot real quick. If you look at Paramount Plus, for example, or
Apple
you know,
TV.
Or Apple TV, right? Like, so Paramount Plus, they're like dragging out the Star Trek episodes, right? You get one Star Trek episode every week, but they've got 5 Star Trek series, so they can like slowly bleed you out for the entire year, so you can't unsubscribe. Disney Plus is doing this with Marvel and Star Wars series, right? We just started Book of Boba Fett right after Hawkeye ended. It's less about what Bridget is talking about, which is that awesome ability to kind of discuss a show as it's going, and it's more about like what they can get away with so that we stay subscribed and give them all our money.
Star Wars is never going to end, I guess. All right, so we waited so long for Antlers. I finally got to see it the other day.
I warned you, your mileage would vary.
Yeah. Man.
Sorry. I mean, the monster's
cool. Don't bother is my review, I guess.
The monster's cool,
but I mean, you get there in the last 10 minutes. And the rest of the time, I mean, if you're making a movie about a depressing town that, you know, has a lot of poor people and needs help and everything, it's a great movie, you know. But if you're making a horror film, it's not so much. Okay, one of my favorites was The Vigil. I've watched it twice.
That's a good movie.
Yeah. You know, the creeping dread in that movie is just handled superbly. Who was it? Hitchcock said a bomb under the table that explodes is surprise, and a bomb under the table that does not explode is suspense. So...
I like the ending of that because it has a sort of It Follows feel to it.
Yeah.
You're looking
although
down
the street. Although maybe it wasn't following him is all I can say without spoiling.
Yes.
So, yeah, I'm not a 2021 movie, but I love It Follows. So, Conjuring the Devil Made Me Do It was complete crap.
Every single one of those Conjuring movies has been complete crap. I don't know why.
No, the first two were pretty good.
No.
For what they were.
I hated the first. I only saw the first one and The Nun, and I hated both of those films. I really hated the first one.
I haven't seen The Nun one.
Don't.
It seems like they're formulas, you know?
Yeah.
They're definitely formulas. Yeah.
They're like PG-13 takes on The Exorcist. Except The Exorcist, at least they had kind of a vague idea of what they were doing. And this, they just kind of wing it. Like, you know what's cool is, like, Poltergeist. Cool. Let's have books fly all around the room.
Ugh. All right, so I mentioned Advent Calendar. I mentioned The Vigil. All right, two more movies I'll mention that I had hopes for, but was kind of disappointed. I mean, they were just okay, was The Night House and The Deep House. So The Deep House was basically what? Ghosts underwater, get out of there before you run out of oxygen or something. I mean, it just, yeah. And The Night House really had some creepy, creepy moments in it. But ultimately, I don't think the movie worked. But that's just my opinion. But it definitely had some creepy moments in it. And I would say to any horror fan, should you watch The Deep House? No, skip it. But should you watch The Night House, give it a try and see what you think of it. There's definitely some creepy moments in there.
The Night House is distinct from The Lighthouse.
Yes.
With William Dafoe, which is an excellent movie.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then go ahead, Rick.
No, I didn't say that Robert Pattinson was also in it. Uh-huh.
And very... I...
All right, go ahead,
Rick. No, go ahead, Rick.
It's a very poetic movie.
Yes.
People going insane. Excellent study. And I'll let you go now, Pete.
No, Bridget did bring up The Manor, and I had to say she's right. It's not a great film, but it does do some interesting things by turning the trope on its head. And, you know, having the old people being heroes rather than the villains. Yeah.
All right, so books. I've had a couple of these authors on. Of course, Gus is gone now, but I did honestly love This Thing Between Us by Gus Marino, and that's why we asked him on the show. Same with The Last House on Needless Street by Catriona Ward. Is very, very different, and different done well is always good. very surprising book. Chasing the Boogeyman by Richard Chismar. I think that was this year. Yeah, I interviewed Rich earlier this year. And then Whisper Down the Lane by Clay Chapman. I had him on too, and that's a very good book. The Seven Visitations of Sidney Burgess. Has anyone read this one? That is, I'm sorry, I'm blanking on the author. Let me Google it real quick. But that's a really, really good book. Andy Marino is the author. You know, it's one of those books that you can't really say too much about without spoiling it. My friend Larry sent me a Kindle edition of The Book of Accidents by Chuck Wendig. He says I'll really, really like it. And if I do, he wants me to get Chuck on the show. I don't know if that much pull, but we'll see. Thanks for sending me that, Larry. I read a little bit about it. It's supposed to be extremely good. A collection I read that came out this year that's extremely good is Where All Is Night and Starless by John Linwood. Let me just read you. I don't think I have it here. He makes a statement in the introduction that sometimes the creepy thing in the woods is more immediate than the cosmic horror in the stars. I'm paraphrasing that badly, but something to that effect. But he does really great with it. It's a really, really good book. I really recommend it. Where All Is Night and Starless by John Linwood. The Monsters We Make by Callie White is very good. And Crossroads by Laurel Hightower came out early in 2021, I think. And it's a real gut punch. It's a very good novella. And especially if you're a parent, it's really a gut punch. Last but not least, not necessarily a horror novel, but a genre novel, is The Flying Nun by Cody Goodfellow. And that's N-O-N-E. And if you've read Cody Goodfellow, you know how out there his work can be. So, and as far as TV goes, I had more books than anything else. I was just going to say Chapel 8, which we've already talked about. And I was going to say, I just discovered today a show called The Girl in the Woods. And it looks really interesting. And apparently it's about this group that dwell in the woods. There's a door in the woods that, and behind it, there's these cosmic horrific nightmares. And apparently they battle to keep them from coming out. So I'm going to give it a try. It looks really good. The trailer looked really, really good. So anyway, that's what I got. Rick stepped away for a minute. So who do we got left? Bill and Rick. What do you got, Bill?
One thing, I know this won't work. I wanted to put this up here. I don't know if anybody can see that, but.
Yeah, Soylent Green.
Yeah, look 2022.
2022.
Oh, there's going to be a.
No, it's set in 2022.
It's set in 2022.
Oh, that's right. That's.
That came across my Twitter feed today, and I thought, awesome. It's the year of Soylent Green. You know, it's also the year of Blade Runner, too. So I was walking through Barnes & Noble, and I saw this book, and the title was Zoe Punches the Future in the Dick. And it was the funniest title I've ever seen. And I picked up the book, and it's by a guy named David Wong. And I went back and read all his stuff. And it's science fiction and horror and comedy and all these things mushed together.
Yeah, he's the guy who wrote John Dies at the End.
Exactly. John Dies at the End is probably my favorite book that he did. And there's actually a movie adaption of that, which I've got the DVD, but haven't got to watch it yet.
It was fairly decent, actually.
Yeah.
I really loved it.
It, you know, it's not horror, but there's a lot of horrific things in it. It's just, and I just went back and just started reading everything that he did. And it's just, it's hard to find good funny stuff, and there's just a lot of humor in there. And so, you know, I just discovered him and just been going through all his stuff. As to TV shows, they're not strictly horror, but I love Sweet Tooth, Lost in Space, and Invincible, which is a comic book adaptation that's got a lot of really crazy stuff in it that's horrific. And it's a movie that horrifies me, even though it's not horror. Have you all seen Don't Look Up?
Yes.
Leonardo DiCaprio is on Netflix. Just came out.
I've seen the first quarter of it.
That was amazing.
Yeah, it's basically the premise of it, not the plot of it, but the premise of it is what happens when your leaders are a bunch of idiots and something really bad happens. What do you do then?
So reality. And
exactly. And it's very rare these days that I have a movie that bothers me and stays with me for days. And just the idea that, you know, our leaders seem to be so witless these days. And what if something bad, you know, happens? What are we going to do? And so that movie just stayed with me.
You know, you kind of have to come to grips with the fact that we live on a knife's edge of something bad could happen at any time. And the people that we think are there to stop those things from happening aren't necessarily going to do that. It reminds me of, I think his name was Arkhipov. Remember that incident in the 80s where the Russians thought we had fired nuclear missiles?
Mm-hmm.
And this Russian nuclear commander, submarine commander, I believe, was ordered to fire back on the United States. Of course, we hadn't fired, but he correctly, as it turned out, thought it was a computer error. Just a couple of blips on a screen almost started World War III. So, you know, if you're alive today, most likely it's because of this one guy. He saved the world because he didn't follow orders. That kind of stuff is exactly what you're talking about, Bill.
There were actually two Russian guys who saved the world. There was the one in the 80s, and there was one during the Cuban Missile Crisis.
Oh, right.
It was a submarine commander in the Cuban Missile Crisis who refused to fire. I think it was the state technician in the 80s.
Okay. Yeah, I might have that backwards, but you could see how easily, just right there, the world could have ended, basically.
We once did, you know, a list of the greatest people in the millennium. Those are the two missing names.
Yeah. Well, last but not least, where'd Rick go?
I'm here.
Oh, there he is. Okay, sorry. What do you got, Rick?
Okay, we mentioned a lot. I didn't read that much horror, but I mainly read anthologies. And the standout was Under Twin Suns.
Oh,
James Chambers from Bible Campus Press with the King in Yellow Altman history. They had great stories. The ones I remember best are the ones by Don Lane and our beloved Gil Pulver.
Yeah, Under Twin Suns has a never published before story by Joe Pulver in it. So.
This sort of his response to More Light by James Bliss. I won't say anymore. It's about writing The King in Yellow.
And if you have Kindle Unlimited, Under Twin Suns is on there right now. So you can read it for free.
All right, Rick, anything else?
Yeah, now Ben mentioned a superhero movie that's not a horror movie. I'm going to mention a superhero movie that is a horror movie that's actually sort of a prequel to it. Venom 2. Let There Be Carnage. That is, that right after I got out of it, I said, I really saw a horror movie.
I was wondering whether I should rent that or not.
And it's not a criticism, but I'm just saying it's a very good horror movie. It's a good horror comedy, in fact. of all the elements, an asylum, a serial killer, an opposing monster who, Venom may be the hero in that movie, but he's still killing people.
How's it stack up against the first one?
It's better than the first one.
Really?
Much better, honestly. Much better.
Okay, good to know.
Now, for television, besides everything we've said before, I would add, I like The Witcher, and the first episode of that is really a horror episode. It uses a very traditional monster, which I'm not going to reveal what it is, even though they have a different name for it. You know exactly what that monster is by the end. For the Brux in the episode, but something else. And I like Lock and Key, which is the adaptation of the Joe Hill graphic novel, which came back for a second season.
Have you seen the second one or just the first season?
I've seen both.
I saw the first season last year when I was laid up with COVID, but I haven't seen the second one yet.
They pretty much finished the graphic novel in those two seasons, but they leave room for a third. They start a different plot line or a related plot line.
Okay.
But they've changed some things that the town is not called Lovecraft, it's called Matheson, after Richard Matheson. And they, so far as of yet, have not had an overt Cthulhu Mythos reference in this story. Now, let's see, there was Evil. Second season I recommend highly for reasons we've already discussed. And I think that's probably it.
Okay. I really, right in the first episode of Evil, that scene where she's laying in bed in the dark, and I love stuff like this, where all of a sudden you realize that something's been standing there all along. You know, mm-hmm. It's not this surprise, you know, jump scare type thing. It's just like, it was done really well. So
the scariest episode this season is the one with the elevator. If you've seen it.
Yeah, I'm about halfway through that one. I've got to go back and finish that one. Yeah.
Which season is that in?
It's the second season, the elevator one.
Okay, haven't seen that yet. Yeah.
That one was incredibly suspenseful in the middle of the episode.
All right. Yeah, so anything else? Did we forget or want to mention? Anybody forget anything?
Well, I want to say while we're talking about Chapelwaite, it made me think about, are we not in the golden age of Stephen King adaptions? I mean, there was some good ones in the beginning and then a whole lot of bad ones. And there's just so many good ones that have been coming out in the last few years.
I'm wondering how that affected Castle Rock, because they kind of did a Jerusalem Slot that wasn't reflective of the short story for the second season. But they have a rights issue, so they just, you know, call it Jerusalem Slot and everything but name.
No, there's not a rights issue because Stephen King was a part of putting that together. They're just trying to do something different than what was, you know, just mimicking the books.
Okay.
Guys, what was that short story that was a bit of a sequel to Salem's Lot? Can't remember the title.
It's called Jerusalem's Lot.
One for the road.
That's it. One for the road.
Yeah.
I would love to see a good horror anthology series. Make that as an episode and do it right. That's one of my favorite.
On YouTube, there's like a half hour adaptation of it.
Really?
Yeah, I came across it on YouTube one day. It's not, I wouldn't say it's overwhelming, but it's above average, I'll say.
Yeah.
I always liked the adaptation of The Night Flyer because it has that with, he was from Twin Peaks.
Yeah. I know who you mean. Farrar.
Yeah.
I'm forgetting his first name. He's
Jose Mel. Ferrer. It's Mel. Mel Ferrer. Jose Ferrer's son. Yeah. Yeah, that's a good adaption.
It's short too, but it's good.
Man, it's been like 20 years since I've seen that. Yeah, Miguel Ferrer.
Miguel Ferrer. Yeah.
Yeah.
Miguel Ferrer is a different actor. That's what I was confusing him with.
Yeah, you know, he had this very kind of old school appeal to him, I always thought. Mm-hmm. You know, hard noir. Nose. Yeah, kind of noir look to him. So, all right. Yeah. Got anything else, Rick?
No, that's it.
All right. Well, I don't have anything else either, except to say that this, for Patreons, this Thursday, Alan Hughes and I are going to discuss Lovecraftian video games. So if you're a Patreon, which is only $5 a month, you can watch us live, like just like this show, or you can watch or listen later. So then I saw a photo of the Overlook, 1921. Have you seen this, Pete?
The hotel?
Yeah, with a bunch of people in it.
No, I haven't seen the photo.
New Year's Eve, 1921.
Are you sure that's not the one from the film?
Yeah, I think it's the one from the film.
Okay. No, but they do this photo of
the, right.
Yeah.
And okay. And Jack's in it.
Yeah.
Well, I found a website today with a theory on why Jack's in it. Reincarnation, okay. I guess. But anyway, so I hope everybody enjoyed our takes on the best of 2021. And before Pete passes out, yeah, Matt's got a prize.
No, you have to be 18 or older for that.
Like anyone watching this show is under 60. Anyway.
Wow. The entire audience.
Wow.
So, the prize is a Lady Death comic.
I am under 60.
I'm under 60.
The art is actually.
I am not under 60.
If you want to win this book, send an email to ezineprizes@gmail.com. Put Lady Death in the subject heading. We'll choose a winner in like 5-6 weeks. Maybe you'll win it.
Well, it wouldn't be a Lovecraft eZine podcast episode if I didn't have to apologize for Matt. So
I have some news I want to tell you guys.
All right, go ahead.
I turned in the final manuscript for The Eldritch Equations.
Oh, nice.
Good. It's a sequel to the Miskatonic.
Yes.
You know the whole title.
Miskatonic University Spiritualism Club, or yeah, MUSC.
Which, by the way, I've got a link to that for anybody watching or listening. I've got a link to that, and I've got a link to Scott Thomas's new book as well.
So, yeah, I've turned that in. It's done.
In the show notes, I mean. Yeah.
And, yeah, we should have it out in August.
Who? Same publisher?
Same publisher.
Yeah,
Jack and Nate Press.
Speaking of August,
that's such a beautiful.
There's a reason for that date, right?
Yes, there's a reason for that date.
Because remember, unless COVID supervenes, look for tickets to the Necronomicon convention to go on sale sometime near the end of this month. Yeah. It is like the third weekend in August. It will be in Providence. Please plan to attend. Many of us try to go if we can, because gosh, you know, we got to meet our groupies. But anyway, there's a lot of fun stuff. That there's scholarship, there's fiction, there are movies, there's plays, there's readings, there's music. It's just the
thing. I drink a lot.
So some that's of the music comes from Pete singing.
There are like three trivia nights.
Oh yeah, Pete does trivia nights there. Yeah.
So there's a lot of reasons to go. So start looking it up, put it on your calendar.
And there's even trivia that I don't know.
Say
50% of the trivia Pete comes up with, I don't know.
You insulted one of my favorite people. Emma Gibbon says, "Excuse me." I think she's referring to the 60 years old and over comment. So yeah.
I'm under 60.
I hope Mike you feel bad.
60. Ben's under 60.
I hope you feel really like bad.
25.
But Pete, you don't watch the show.
This is true.
In a way, it does. All right. Before we crash and burn, thanks everybody for watching. And
Happy New Year, everybody.
Yeah, Happy New Year. And for listening, if you're listening later. And next week, next episode, we're going to have Matt Carden. So that should be really fun.
Very intellectual.
Very interesting guy to talk to. So, all right.
I probably won't be here, but, you know, we'll see. I'll try and make it home.
No, I think you're on that level, Ben. Or not Ben, Pete. I think you're on that level. I think you can talk to Matt Carden.
No, I'm going away.
Oh, okay.
For a couple days to deal with issues.
You're going away? Does this involve a straight jacket or anything?
Yes.
Manacles.
Absolutely.
All right. Thanks, everybody, for watching and listening, and we will see you next time. Thanks.
Bye.
Bye, everybody.